Dennis, we've hit that halfway mark of 2023. Give us a summary of the first half and the key data points you're looking at that are going to make up that second half of the year.
Right. So the start of the year, the first half of the year, is dominated by the Fed and other central banks around the world hiking interest rates aggressively. Right. And so 75 basis point rate hikes. We've seen the odd 100 point basis rate hike, and steadily since, I would say, it began in 2021. So that's dominated sort of the investment landscape, the return landscape. And so there's been a lot of chatter this year about the fact that if we look at the US equity markets, six or seven stocks have really dominated the returns. And if you strip them out, the market is flat to slightly down. So that's really what has dominated sort of the equity landscape. And that's all been driven by, of course, inflation. And whether you want to say that parts of it were transitory and parts of it weren't, parts of it were driven by fiscal policy, we're seeing globally inflation at elevated levels and central banks hiking rates in an attempt to bring that under control. So that's really dominated the last 6 months of equity markets. Looking forward, we would expect that all of those rate hikes in the tank are going to start to eat into economic output, right? So there's two impacts from hiking interest rates. There's the impact on discount rates and cost of borrowing, and then there's the impact on actual economic performance. So it's harder for companies to get capital, it's more expensive, and so as a result, they probably hire fewer people, they take on less expansionary growth projects, and economic output declines. We have yet to see that impact. And so when people are calling for a recession later this year or early next year, it's really that knock-on effect of all of the interest rate hikes that are going to start to slow global growth that are going to push us into recession. That's kind of the narrative that I think a lot of people are looking forward to for the second half of the year or into next year.
So then I guess, how would you characterize it? Have the markets priced this in, or what are the markets anticipating? What are they? I know you don't have that crystal ball, but what do you think the markets are expecting?
Yeah, it's never priced in, Larysa. I actually just had this conversation with a colleague downstairs. It's never priced in. So when the event happens, there's never 100% certainty. And so when the event does happen, there's always the adjustment factor for whatever segment of the market didn't price it in, but it's never 100% priced in. The challenge I think you have right now for a recession is that this is probably the most anticipated recession I've ever seen in my 20 years. You know, you have Uber drivers telling you there's going to be a recession. The yield curve has been inverted for over a year. And so the challenge I have is that when companies and management teams are anticipating a recession for this long, they take steps to mitigate the impact, which may actually deter or push the recession out. Now, I've got a theory for you, Larysa. I think what we may end up seeing is rolling recessions in various different industries. Take energy, for instance. A couple of years ago, oil traded as low as negative $40 a barrel. That was clearly a recession in energy. More recently, financial services. What with the knock-on effects of First Republic and SVB and Signature Bank, clearly financials have had their own little recession. Healthcare, specifically biotech, even technology. All of these subsectors have had what I call rolling recessions. There's probably more going forward that we're going to experience as various different parts of the economy adjust to the new interest rate environment, the new environment for inflation. So we may not get the technical recession of two quarters back to back of negative growth. We may just experience rolling recessions in various subsectors until we finally shake all of this out. And that would imply an extended period of low growth, but still an attractive environment for businesses to actually generate strong earnings and revenue growth.
Let's talk about a sector that you, that it is a big part of what you do, that you continue to watch is REITs, and I guess the commercial aspect of it. But maybe if you could just break down, because it's not just lumped into the commercial part of it. I'm sure you've recently heard the report from CBRE with respect to office vacancy being the lowest since, or rather the highest, I should say, since 1994. That's looking back at Q2. What does that tell us?
Well, it tells you that you shouldn't be investing in office property, right? I mean, quite simply, I think we talk a lot about commercial real estate, but it's not commercial real estate. It is office real estate that is struggling. I happen to be in the office today, as is most of my team, but various companies have chosen to execute different hybrid programs, different return to work programs. And so right now, what you're seeing is that in a lot of markets like Toronto, like New York, like say Calgary, for instance, you've got elevated vacancy in office real estate. And the outlook is for that to continue for quite some time. Now, that has nothing to do with residential real estate, cell towers, data centers, industrial real estate. So it's really don't invest in office real estate right now. But those other four sectors that I mentioned, they are at all-time highs in terms of occupancy. They're generating robust revenue growth and rent growth. And as a result, you're seeing cash flow growth and distribution growth. So, you know, avoid office, but those other four sectors I mentioned are very attractive.
What about retail? Another, I guess, subsector of commercial, but touch on retail for us.
Yeah, so you want to break retail into two different groups. One is necessity retail, and the other is everything else. Okay, so necessity retail is literally properties that are anchored by drugstores, that are anchored by grocery stores, things that people have to buy, prescriptions that have to get filled, food that has to be purchased. On the other side of the spectrum, things like apparel or electronics or other sort of hobby shops. Those are things that are going to be more cyclical. And as a result, if we do go into recession or a prolonged period of lower growth, you are going to see, you know, the return from those types of retail assets deteriorate over time. Do I think they're about to fall off a precipice? Are they going to hit 19% vacancy like office recently has? I don't believe so. But I think if you need or have to have exposure to retail real estate, it should be really skewed towards the necessity retailers, the drugstores and the grocery anchored shopping centers.
You've pretty much broken down the risks and the opportunities to all of the sectors that are within that fall under commercial. As you see it, industrial and cell tower, are they basically averse to the landscape of high interest rates, inflation? How do you look at it?
Well, nobody is looking at NVIDIA and saying, well, interest rates are going up, and so NVIDIA is going to be worth less. And the reason for that is because they have demonstrable and transparent growth, right? They have come out and reported strong earnings growth. They have made the link between AI and the demand for their products. And so when investors look at NVIDIA, they see growth that offsets rising interest rates. So when you take that back to real estate, yes, we see data centers, cell towers, industrial, residential. Those are subsectors within real estate that have significant amounts of growth that offset the increase in interest rates. It's not just about interest rates going up. It's about how much growth does the industry that you're investing in have to offset the impact of rising interest rates.
Dennis, is there something in this picture that you're looking at that we haven't touched on? We've talked about the most obvious data points, inflation, interest rates. Is there anything else that you're looking at for the second half of the year?
Absolutely. And that's the labor market. Okay. So all central banks right now are trying to get inflation under control. unemployment, if we just look at the US at 3.4%, that's at an all-time low. And so the challenge for the Federal Reserve Bank in this case is to erode the labor market a little bit so that wage inflation comes down such that households can't continue to pay exorbitantly higher prices. And so inflation comes down. Well, so we're paying attention to the labor market. And if you look at the Bank of Canada, they had paused hiking interest rates for two meetings, and then they surprised with a 25 basis point rate hike. And the reason why was illustrated the very next week when wage growth was reported and it was 5%. So clearly the Bank of Canada now wants to hike rates to put some downward pressure on wage inflation. That is the same thing that is happening in the United States. And if we look across the Atlantic in the UK, they've got 9% inflation. They're going to continue to hike interest rates until they can get that under control. And that is going to mean the labor market has to get a little weaker. There have to be fewer jobs there have to be fewer job openings, and there needs to be more people looking for those jobs. And the only way central banks can manage that is by raising interest rates such that there's less growth potential in the economy, less need for more labor, less need for more investment. And that would mean that the existing people searching for jobs would have to work that much harder, and that would put downward pressure on wage inflation.